The Natural Dying Living Will cards is an advanced care planning tool. I recommend everyone sort the cards twice. In between the first and second sortings, and this could be a month or more, they can think about their decisions and discuss them with their proxy agents, their loved ones, and their counselors and advisors. This video starts with Melissa Cook sharing her feelings about the changes that she just made after she finished the sorting. This is then a recap. We'll put what you see next into perspective. As background, you should realize that Melissa Cook has significant motivation to diligently create her natural dying living will because she did not want to die like so many other people in her family who suffered from dementia. No argument, to use your words from April. And that's the deal.
Okay.
You got it.
Thank you.
Oh, you're welcome. How come you're smiling?
Well, I'm happy it's done. I'm happy I had a chance to redo it and rethink it.
What was it like for you to do it twice?
It was a completely different experience. In the first situation, I was absolutely in control, and I clearly told my audience, there is no argument, there is no discussion, I have made up my mind, I'm not going to go down that path, because so much of this is philosophical, and parenthetically, I don't really care what you think, I only care what I want. And there's not any really nice way to say that, except to say that.
And so it's your life.
They had to sit there and listen to me go through all 48 cards. I didn't provide the reasoning. I had given them the stories ahead of time to give them context for why I was so adamant about my decisions.
Of your grandmother, your father, and your brother.
Right. And so when I came to the cards, I said, here's the card, here's the picture, and this is what I want. And in every single case, I said, I want natural dying by itself.
Every single case.
And that was in April. And since then, life goes on. You have new conversations. You see people in different lights. They have a chance to think about what you said. For example, my proxy, Shauna, had a chance to see me in a new way and to be concerned and worry what her role would really be. And so the opportunity to go back and try to see it from her point of view and to understand her concerns, in dialogue, not be so, and I don't consider myself to be a narrow-minded person, but I was narrow-minded when I did the cards because I just was adamant that I am not going to live past the time when it's time for me to die, because I had way too many years as a caregiver watching that and being helpless.
Okay, you were so afraid of prolonged dying in advanced dementia that you were willing to give up some quality of life.
Absolutely.
Earlier. So to avoid that possibility.
Absolutely.
To avoid that risk. That's called the dementia fear. And the dementia fear is, if I don't end my life now when I can, then I won't be able to die when I want to later. And the sacrifice is worth it. Except it's not, because you don't have to. Because if you go through the diligent advanced care planning, which you have, and you have this criteria for natural dying, very clear, very specific, which unfortunately your brother did not have, then you do know when. And up to that point, you get treat and feed. And after that point, you get natural dying. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. So yeah, it was a completely different experience, and I'm very grateful to you for wanting to do it again with me.
Now let's watch an excerpt from the second sorting of Melissa Cook, in which she made some changes and explains why. But since you've sorted the cards a number of times, you can make a three-way choice the first time through this afternoon. So which would it be? If it's natural dying, would it be consider along with other items, or by itself it's enough?
By itself it's enough.
And why is that?
Because I want to know who I am. When I don't want to be disoriented. I don't want to be in a state of not knowing. I don't want to not be able to know who I'm communicating to or what I'm communicating about. I mean, I would have to know it's me if someone came in the room and tried to have a dialogue with me.
Okay.
And I didn't even know who I was, there wouldn't be a dialogue because they wouldn't be talking with me because okay. I wouldn't even know who I was.
Okay, so knowing who you are is essential for you.
Essential.
Okay. What about the second one now, 1.2?
I cannot remember the important events in my life. If reminded, I don't know why they are important. Originally, I did say natural death on that, and I would reconsider because I already don't remember important events in my life mm-hmm. and don't know why they are important, and I still have a good life.
Okay. All right. So would it be treat and feed, or would it be natural dying with other items?
I think it would probably be treat and feed.
Okay. Can you describe what's going on in the line drawing here?
The person is in bed, and a son or somebody is saying, "Look, don't you remember when you won this wonderful award? You were an Olympic medalist." And
right.
the person's going, "Really? I was?"
No. Well, you've done two things at the same time. You've made a choice. You've explained your choice. And you've explained why you changed your mind.
If someone calls my name, I say nothing. I do not turn toward the person, yet my hearing is fine. So in the picture, a man is sitting there in a state of what I would consider duh, mm-hmm. and somebody is hollering, even though it's not necessary, George.
Mm-hmm.
For me, that picture represents, again, a blankness, an emptiness. If I don't respond to my name, that one correlates with I don't know who I am. So if I don't even know my name, then I most likely wouldn't know who I am or have a sense of my own self or being. And in that state, my picture in my mind is that it's just emptiness. It's
so
just fog. So it's natural dying.
With other items or by itself?
By itself.
Okay.
This card says, I cannot remember my basic values or my life goals or what I felt was important for my life to be good. This is another one that I have changed. Maybe I won't remember my life goals. My life goals have certainly changed in the last few years. I believe my basic values are the same, but I think the priority of them has definitely shifted. And again, I think there's a shift in what's important for my life to be good. So maybe I wouldn't remember, maybe I'd just shift it. And maybe I felt it was critical to be a good mother or a good grandmother. And I don't feel that in the future, but I'm interested in preserving habitat for butterflies.
Whatever it is.
So just because I don't remember them doesn't mean that my life would be over.
Okay.
My life would be different.
Mm-hmm.
I might be unrecognizable to people who were in my past life.
Mm-hmm.
But I would want treat and feed. The way I act shows that I forgot my lifelong ideals. If I could see my future actions now, I would feel shame. And I'd feel sorry, since my actions would hurt my husband or my wife and others like children. This is another one where I'm going to change.
Well, first tell us what's going on in the line drawing.
Okay, the line drawing. What's happening is the person with the disease or dementia is in bed with someone who apparently is not his or her spouse. And a visitor's walking in, and the visitor's going, "Oh my God, what's happening here? I think there's been enough stories, anecdotes, even sitcom, you know, stories on television where you've seen this exact scenario where the person with the dementia has forgotten who he or she is, has forgotten about past relationships and created new ones. And so the words that I would feel shame and sorry since my actions would hurt my husband, wife, and others, if I took up with another person, yes, that would be hurtful, but I don't know that it would be intentionally hurtful. It would be as part of the progression of the disease and that reinvention of self that a person with dementia doesn't have any control over. I think you can have dementia and still have loving feelings toward other people.
Yes.
And that would be very hurtful mm-hmm. to family.
Mm-hmm.
So it would be hard, but it would be up to my family to just figure it out that it wasn't about them, it was the disease.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And so before I said, no, I would want natural dying in that situation. And what I've learned is that I am changing. Mm-hmm. And I do have different interests. And they may not be in concert with my past life. But I don't get to have my past life come forward with me. I don't mm-hmm. get to choose whether it's going to come mm-hmm. forward or not.
Mm-hmm.
I just get to live with what I get.
Right.
So, if that were to happen, I would be sad for anyone who I would hurt.
Right.
I don't want natural death. I would want treat and feed.
Okay.
Because people could perceive that I was truly out of my mind. And that wouldn't be a correct perception. It would mean okay. that I had moved to a different state of the disease.
Right. Okay. Very well explained. Thank you.
I cannot recall my past. I no longer know what gave my life deep meaning, yet I can still enjoy living. Man, I'm changing on all of these. Golly, what gave my life? Okay, the picture is...
To her credit, Melissa Cook is a very independent kind of person, and she was able to sort the Natural Dying Living Will cards right out of the box, the first time without anyone's help. Her motivation was very high, as you will appreciate if you view another one of her videos in this series where she tells the stories of how her grandmother, her father, and her brother died, all of whom, like other members of her family as well, were afflicted with Alzheimer's disease. The point is that if Melissa had not discussed her decisions with others and changed her mind, then she might have instructed her future physicians and her proxy agent to stop treatment earlier due to her dementia fear, and she would have thus had a premature dying. Melissa also changed her mind during the course of our interview, perhaps due to my persuasion. We'll now skip ahead to the very last card, which we discussed for over 12 minutes. The excerpt is about one-third of that time.
And this will be the last one.
All right. First, I can enjoy things like eating, sing-alongs, finger painting, and being touched. Then I get very sick. Ask my doctor if I might get better. If yes, treat me full treatment for a reasonable time.
And what's going on in the line drawing?
Well, the patient is in bed with a oxygen mask and hooked up to some antibiotic. And even though she's sick, she's still remembering, oh, I'm missing out on, they're doing the sing-along right now.
Right.
So she appears to be unhappy that she's sick and missing out on activities. So for this one, I would say natural dying, but consider with other items, like how hard is it to bathe me, how aggressive I am, other things like that. So natural dying with considering other items.
Okay. Well, if this person has the ability to enjoy the simple pleasures of life, what's one if? And the second if the doctor's right, because he said you might get better, and if you did get better, then you can go back to all those activities which you were enjoying, why would you not want to accept treat and feed?
Yes, I may enjoy simple things like finger painting, sing-alongs. I believe those are very limited pleasures in life. I don't consider that to be the quality of life that represents who I am.
Now, it's who you are now. You might change. Let me point out to you that the professionals who deal with and treat and counsel people with disabilities have often found a paraplegic, and previously was the head of the ball team. I would never want to live in a wheelchair. I would rather die than live in a wheelchair. Changes his mind, goes to law school, has a marriage and children and so on and so forth. So people do accommodate to disabilities. So right now you're saying that eating sing-alongs, finger painting, being touched, even though you seem to enjoy it, is not enough for you. And it's a very difficult decision for you to make now. May I suggest an alternative here?
Sure.
Okay. Why not let your proxy agent, in consultation with your loved ones and your caregivers and your physician, decide when that time comes?
Well, here's where my stubbornness, I guess, comes out. Mm-hmm. I would agree to treat and feed with the stipulation that if I did not get any better after 2 weeks, and I would want natural dying.
Absolutely. Of course, if it came to that and they say, you know, she's so much better after 2 weeks, but not completely better, they would continue the treatment. 3 weeks, and then they would take you off the treatment and you go back. And if you're not better, then it would be natural dying. The other thing I wanted to say about this particular scenario is that there are many people in this world, in this profession, who do not know about natural dying, who do not know that the ironclad strategy can say, if I meet these criteria in the future, then I want natural dying. So what happens is they have a person who's doing pretty well, enjoying life, like that lady at the table who you were pretty sure she was waving to the guy at the next table that you would want to be treated and fed. Then she gets pneumonia and they say, you know what? She has dementia. It's only going to get worse. She could go for 10 years because her age and her physical health is okay. Why don't we take advantage of the opportunity and just not treat a pneumonia? That happens day in and day out across the nation, thousands of times. And it deprives people of precious life. So instead of that, we want to teach people about natural dying. And for this complicated decision, 8.6, if you're not sure, then you defer to your proxy agent.